what information we do have about him. And when we start to really look at it, we might be surprised to find there's a lot there, more than we realized. Every few years, there's just another book that comes out on Jesus from some scholar and all that, and it's like, oh, some new, and really there's no new information. It's not like they found some hidden documents that no one ever saw before. It's pretty, these things have been gone over so often. But usually what justifies more books coming out is that we gain more insight into the historical situation of the ancient Mediterranean world or the Jewish world or something like that. And so then that gives us maybe another way of looking at the material, the data we do have on Jesus. And also scholars will develop different methodologies on how to interpret that material, the New Testament material. So we are growing in our understanding, but it's not like there's any new information coming out. So sometimes television shows or something like that will be, they want to have viewings, and so they'll act real provocative, like this is new stuff coming out. Nothing's new. Okay, I'm going to remove this. But Jesus must have been an extraordinary person. And when I speak like this, I have faith in Jesus, because you know, to me, he's divine, and I have he's at the heart and center of my spirituality. But when we're speaking as an academic or speaking from a historical point of view, then it shifts the language a little bit how I will speak of him. So I'm not speaking as a person of faith when I say some of the remarks I make, but just this is just what we know in scholarly circles. So when I say Jesus must have been extraordinary, of course I believe that, and I have my theological reasons why. But looking at it from purely a historical point of view, what an extraordinary human being he must have been, that he had such an impact on the lives of those around him, and that in a very and movements in the ancient world. There were movements, social movements that developed, but they were few and far between because they didn't have the means of communication that we have today. And so there are all kinds of movements that spring up all the time. We're used to seeing movements because we're exposed to all this through our media. But in the ancient world, it would be very difficult for someone to start a movement. You can't say, I'm going to start a movement and go out and try to start a movement. Well, you can't really do that today so much. But it was really next to impossible. So the fact that an obscure rabbi the eastern portion of the Roman Empire would create a mass movement is really quite extraordinary. And so that says a lot about the personality, the person of Jesus, and the effects that he had. And of course, it's quite extraordinary. People think highly of their teachers, and he had disciples. And we would expect his disciples to speak highly of him. But no one is, like for example, the followers of Socrates might have had a high opinion of him, you know. But they didn't really regard him as being divine, did they? Plato didn't regard Socrates as being divine. So it becomes very extraordinary that they would, that their experience of Jesus was such that they would begin to talk about him as being divine. That's really quite extraordinary, particularly when it's coming from Jewish people. You know, if it was the Romans or the Greeks that said he was divine, well, okay, you know, they had a polytheistic religious background, and so they didn't have difficulty thinking of an extraordinary person as having divine qualities. But for Jews, that would have been something. And of course, they were convinced he was the Messiah. Now, the Jesus movement begins with the person of Jesus And when you're at church this Sunday, pay close attention to the gospel, because it is the calling of the fishermen, of his first disciples, which is a delightful story, but it just, that's the beginning of the movement. And so the movement, that I call it the Jesus movement. So, oh, look, that's out of ink.
That's not good. I don't think it's back in the
day. Yeah, I should throw it away. Something went wrong here. Are you still hearing me?
We're good.
Okay, we're good. Okay. 1 second, sorry for the delay. Okay, this is the one that's not working. Okay, so I should throw that away, correct?
Yes.
Now let's try again. Okay. Oh, that's great.
Yes.
Nice book. The Jesus movement. I like using this expression because it wasn't really called Christianity until much later. So it is a... it is a social movement that begins in the first century. And the very center of that movement is a person, and that's Jesus of Nazareth. So I'll just put that here at the center, Jesus. And then he calls a circle of disciples around him. And so his life and his story and his teaching breaks out to a small circle of disciples. Okay? That's how movements begin. This inner circle is made up of his earliest disciples. All of them were what we call Palestinian Jews. Remember I mentioned that before?
Except for Jews, right?
Yep.
Palestinian Jew. Did I spell that right? Palestinian Jews.
Yeah, yes.
When we say Palestinian Jews, it's not quite what we mean today by when we're referring to the Arabs who identify themselves as Palestinians. Palestinian Jews were Jews who spoke Aramaic as their primary language, and they lived in the traditional homeland. So they lived in what in biblical times or was called Israel. So that's where they lived. And so there was a pretty sizable Jewish population in Israel in the first century. And the reason it's called Palestine is that's the name the Romans gave it to. And Palestine means the Philistines. And the Philistines, as you know, were an ethnic group that were not, they were not Jews, but they lived along the coastal region there. They were an ethnic group in the same area. So Jesus, primarily, this group of disciples that he had were all Palestinian Jews, Aramaic-speaking Jews who grew up and lived in the ancestral land. And that's really the extent of what happens in Jesus' lifetime. And really, the authorities at the time, when they had Jesus put to death, thought that would be it. Eliminate Jesus and this movement will go away. It didn't go away. And it just continued to grow to the consternation of the religious authorities in Jerusalem. And eventually it would become a problem for the Roman Empire. So what we have in the New Testament is we begin to see that the Jesus movement begins to expand, particularly after his resurrection. And because the earliest followers of Jesus really believed that they saw him alive, raised from the dead. And then they began to proclaim the message. Well, it didn't stay contained within Palestinian Judaism. Movements spread. And then a movement could be contained within a particular boundary of a particular ethnic group or nation and not move beyond that. But the Jesus movement extends beyond the barrier of the Palestinian Jews. And it's another circle of people. And these are called the Jews of the diaspora. So they're still Jews. Diaspora is D-I-A-S-P-O-R-A. The diaspora.
Diaspora.
That's it. Which it's related to the word the dispersion. Because there were Jews that lived outside of the ancestral land. And they did that, they lived outside, some of them, for many generations. And so they adapted the culture and the language of everyday life of wherever they were in the world. It's like the difference between an Israeli today and a New York Jew. And there's actually as many Jews living in New York than there are in Israel. So this is a sizable population. So and in the Roman Empire, the Jews had their own communities. The Jews of the diaspora had their own communities, like in places like Rome. There was a huge Jewish community in Alexandria, but they didn't speak Aramaic like they did back on the old sod. They spoke the language of the Roman Empire, which was Greek-speaking, and so these Jews are called Hellenistic Jews. Jews. These were Jews that had been enculturated in Greek culture, which was the common world culture of the Roman Empire, and they spoke primarily Greek. Why the word Hellenistic? Because the Greek, this is the, this is what the Greeks called their land. And that's, it's transliterated into English as Hellas. Okay? And people who lived and participated or came from this country were called Hellenes. That's what the Greeks called themselves. The word Greek is Latin. That's what the Romans called them. So we call them Greeks. But they didn't self-identify Greeks. They would say Hellas or Hellenes. Anyway, this is why these Jews are called Hellenistic Jews, because they are Jews that spoke the Greek language because they lived in other major urban centers throughout the Roman Empire. There were Jews of the diaspora that lived beyond the Roman Empire, and they didn't speak Greek. Those were the there were Jewish communities that were as far east as India, as far south as Ethiopia and Africa. And they even migrated up into Central Asia. Those Jews did not speak Greek, and they wouldn't be called Hellenistic Jews. So how is it that the movement broke out from the Palestinian Jews among this other population? It is because the Hellenistic Jews would make pilgrimage to Jerusalem on certain feast days. And so they were exposed to the preaching and the proclamation of the followers of Jesus that were Palestinian Jews. So the ever-widening circle is that this is the first crossing over into another defined group. The next group, as the gospel spreads, and we see this in the New Testament documents themselves, it's interesting that it's the Hellenistic Jews that evangelize another ethnic group that's closely related to the Jews, but they're not Jewish. And that is the Samaritans. Now, Jesus did visit and minister to the Samaritans. We know, we have stories of that. The woman at the well, the healing of the leper. So he did have some contact with them, but no Samaritan became a follower of Jesus when it was just him and his disciples. But now Philip, who was a Hellenistic Jew, goes to Samaria and proclaims the gospel. And this really gives you the structure of the Acts of the Apostle, which is the only history that we really have in the New Testament. And so, as you can see, it's like throwing a stone into a quiet pond, and there starts to be these ripples, concentric circles that keep moving out. That's what the gospel is doing. Yes.
So, the Hellenistic Jews of the diaspora heard about Jesus and the Jesus movement originally through going back to Palestine?
Yeah.
They didn't just wait for somebody to come and...
For the most part, they came in contact to the gospel of Jesus and to the Jesus movement because it was big in Jerusalem. And then they would go to Jerusalem and they would pick up on it.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So that's, a lot of this...
It would make sense if they would go back, same as Muslims go to...
Yeah. Well, and the Muslims got this idea is that called the hijab?
Hijab.
They got that from the Jews, because the Jews would go to Jerusalem. So you can see that there a lot of Islam. Islam freely borrows from both Christians and Jews. They did.
The Irish go back and kiss the Blarney Stone.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what the Irish do. Yeah, I know. Yeah. Yeah, they have a holy site. Yeah, I guess you and I better go. Well, anyway,
could I make a comment about Paulie's comment?
Yeah.
When apostles would go to another city, they would who were followers of Jesus, they'd head to a synagogue. So it really is two ways. We've got the Hellenistic Jews coming to Jerusalem for festivals, but we do have occasions when we've got apostles or followers of Jesus who go out somewhere else, and where do they head? The first place they would head to would be a synagogue to be with other Jews.
Yeah, and in fact, that's what happens with the Apostle Paul. That's what he does. That's his methodology. But we do not know that they did that before. Before Paul. That might have been an innovation from the church at Antioch and the missionary journeys of Paul, who started doing that.
The formal kind of missionary.
Yeah, when they went out intentionally to a city that did not have, where the church wasn't, and they would go and they would go to the local synagogue and preach until they got thrown out, and then they'd start the church. That's kind of basically, that was Paul's missionary strategy. That was his pattern. So now the Samaritans are included. Now, what's really interesting, that these groups, there were inbuilt prejudices. For example, the Aramaic Jews looked down upon the Jews of the diaspora because they felt like they became more worldly. They don't follow the traditions exactly in the same way. They're different. And then the Samaritans were really an ethnic group that was despised by both the Hellenistic Jews and the Palestinian Jews. And so the fact that Philip, a Hellenistic Jew, takes the gospel to the Samaritans is really quite extraordinary. But Jesus already set the precedent for that. And the extraordinary thing about Jesus, and this is what inspired these disciples, people usually stayed within the bounds of their ethnic group or their social class. Jesus, in his ministry, was breaking all those barriers. He offered to go to the Roman centurion's house, which a good Orthodox Jew would never do that, because you would render yourself impure, unclean, if you were to go into a Gentile's house. Jesus treated women as equals. And so Jesus, and he heals the Samaritan. He heals the Syrophoenician woman, her child. So you can see that Jesus was somehow this inclusive person, which is a really big departure from his contemporaries. And so it's not surprising then that the example of Jesus is carried on by the disciples. They overcame their prejudices, and it began to expand. In other words, the circle of the Jesus movement is always expanding outward, breaking down boundaries to be more inclusive. That's why eventually we use the word Catholic, which means universal, but it also means inclusive of everybody. So Catholicism is the religion of inclusivity. It's the religion of Jesus. And it goes beyond ethnic, religious, and national identity and gender and all that. It transcends all of that. So the Jesus movement, which is still dynamic and still is dynamic, even in our own time, is always pressing the boundaries and expanding who can be included. And then the biggest thing that happens, and this is recorded in the book of Acts, the Jesus movement penetrates beyond the Samaritans to the Gentiles. This is where you get the Gentile mission. This is quite extraordinary. And because the Samaritans are kind of like the Jews. Okay, we can accept the Samaritans. At least they read the Torah and have some of the same customs and circumcise, you know, but and keep kosher. The Samaritans do that. So they're similar enough to us, but not those Italians. You know, what are you doing bringing those guys in? Well, that's exactly the story. The narrative is showing this. The book of Acts is the story of the expansion of the circle of inclusion. And there was a big fight and controversy in the church when Gentiles started coming in, because many Jews did not want to accept them. So they had a council called the Jerusalem Council, and they resolved that question, and it opened the door for all the Gentiles. And that's the rest of us. So the Jesus movement didn't remain confined within Judaism. It was expanding, and it had a vision that included all the nations of the earth. Gentiles is what it is in Latin, and it simply means the nations.
Is that what they called other people, or is that our word?
I mean, no, that's what the Jews called. If you were not Jewish, they would call you a Gentile. But a Gentile is not it's not a derogatory term. It just means, it literally means the nations, or the ethnic groups, other people of different a national identity with different traditions and customs. And really, the first Gentiles to come into the church were the Romans and the Greeks, the Latins and the Greeks.
So they become. Was the Jerusalem Council?
It would have been about, I'm going to say, between 45, 48, year 45. So we're talking about, we're into the fifth decade. So we're getting halfway through. So about 15 years after Jesus. So it expands outward, and then you will, and then if you study church history, you see that it's constantly moving outward, more inclusive. And so after a while, the Greeks were missionizing the Slavs. And that's where you get the Holy Church of Russia, the Orthodox Church. And then you have the Germans starting to convert. And Christendom in Europe begins to develop. And now, what was so extraordinary for me, after 2,000 years, which really isn't all that long, after 2,000 years, I'm in the Far East. This is what struck me. I was in the Philippines. 95% of the population is Christian there. And I was just reading an article the other day that South Korea, more than 50% of the population is now Christian. And that's extraordinary, because that all happened since World War II. Because before World War II, it was like maybe 0.5% of the population of the Koreans were Christianized. The Chinese church is growing at enormous speed. And who knows, in another century, China may be predominantly a Christian nation. I mean, it's hard for us to wrap our heads around that. Sub-Saharan Africa is practically all Christian. But wherever Christianity goes, it transforms the culture, but the culture also transforms it. So the Catholicism of the Philippines, I recognize it. I can go to Mass there. I'm familiar. I have that in common. Yet there is a kind of Filipino take on Catholicism. They have their own unique things. Just like Mexican Catholicism, Our Lady of Guadalupe is a big deal. Well, Our Lady of Guadalupe is no big deal in Ireland, you know. But there, so there is a Mexican kind of that. So the Christianity will transform the culture, but it also is transforming. And you have Irish Catholicism, which is different than Spanish Catholicism, and Native Americans. Because you integrate it with your culture, and maybe, Thalia, you could say something about that, because I'm fascinated that you were baptized Roman Catholic, so obviously those missionaries generations ago did their job to bringing Christianity to your people, but at the same time, I'm aware that your people maintain their cultural identity and a lot of their religious customs and rituals, they just integrate it with their Catholicism. Do I have that right?
I don't know if it's that clean cut, but yeah. I think that the way that they were approached in the early days, you know, the ancestors, they used the water of baptism to really, because water was very extremely important to our ancestors, and water was sacred, literally.
Yeah.
One of the teachings they had is if you are sad or you hurt or something, you take your two fingers and you go to the local creek and you put your two fingers into the water and you will be, it's almost like you would be healed from that problem. So baptism was a huge part of that whole coming in and baptizing, you know.
So it was using water as an ablution of some kind was already seen as sacred.
And
so
also music. Music was another thing, because the culture was basically, we sang, our ancestors sang for everything, from morning till night.
Yeah.
And they did dances and stuff. So the music of the church, the early church was also, we saw that in the mission movie when we saw that.
Yeah.
You know, they got them singing the songs, and they loved singing.
Yeah.
Well, that was very similar to our culture, where they got them singing the songs, and the devotion already to... There was some sense of a creator already, so it was easy to grasp the concepts of God, of a God,
yeah,
of one God, actually. And so there was all these different things, but at the same time, they kept, one of the biggest things that I tell people when I talk about it is when you go to the old stone church, and you know, they built that church, and it was important to them.
San Juan Capistrano.
Yes. And one of the walls, it's really clear to see also, they put shells and they put obsidian and they put crystals, because crystals was a huge thing, because there was crystals everywhere around here. I mean,
wow.
They used that. They put that into the walls. That was their medicine. So it was a message one day to me that, oh my God, they made it their own. They literally made that building their own.
Wow.
I mean, and we have some other evidence too.
So your ancestors were provided the labor to build the San Juan Capistrano stone church.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what
wow.
They did. But they always had that that sense of spirituality anyway. So it was pretty easy, I think. But you know, and there was also people that kept the culture quiet. You know, so we didn't lose everything, like, you know, the ceremonies and things. But there's still, the people are very Catholic, even though some of them don't go to Mass. But, they, you know, like, our Elder Paschal, Friday night we have the Rosary. Saturday morning we have the Mass. And then we're going to walk him up to the cemetery, which is run by the Archdiocese.
Oh, Holy Sepulchre?
Yeah. Well, no. It's in town. It's actually in San Juan. It's a small cemetery.
Oh, there in San Juan Capistrano?
Right on Ortega Highway.
I didn't know that. Oh, my gosh.
And so that's where he'll be buried with many, many other people up there. And it's definitely something. And then there's some other things, like another saint that was really important to the ancestors was... the Santo Niño de Atoche.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because he held a globe of water. I just found this out the other day because I got it mixed up. He has something in his hand which contains water. And that was a symbol of something really important. So my grandmother had a case of saints in her bedroom. And the Santo Niño de Atoche was like the most important thing.
Santo Niño is the baby Jesus.
Yeah.
We think of him as the infant of Prague.
Well, but yeah. I found out there's a distinction between the two.
Oh, okay.
They're holding different things.
Oh.
So I just recently learned that from Jerry, because I was saying, oh, but the Atoche had the water vessel in his hand. So that was a big deal. So these are all things that played a huge part in the culture, you know, becoming Catholic. And yeah. So I mean, most of the people that are in the tribe, I mean, they all are Catholic. I mean, I did a funeral out in where did we go? We were out a funeral for when we went to those people's houses way out in the middle of nowhere in Temecula, Sun City or somewhere. And I knew they were Catholic. So I immediately said, let's do the Hail Mary. Let's, you know, let's pray. And everyone's just like, oh, yes, we got to do that.
Yeah.
You know, so.
So it's yes. been integrated into yes. the culture of your tribal people.
Yes.
Well. Well, thank you for sharing that. And so just to kind of give you an idea. So this dynamic that began in the first generation has continued throughout history with that as the circle gets larger. And so just a little aside here, I think that when St. Matthew's almost 20 years ago decided to become an inclusive, open, and affirming community. In other words, we were not going to exclude homosexual people and LGBT. There's too many initials now. But anyway, we just thought it was consistent with the trajectory of the Jesus movement, of the gospel, to be inclusive of them too. It's for all human beings. That's what it means to be Catholic. It's universal. And we need to really emphasize, I think, what we do here at St. Matthew's is we try to emphasize the inclusivity of what it means to be Catholic. And because the name Catholic suggests that. But a lot of people will use Catholic as a way of excluding people, which contradicts the meaning of the word. Okay, anyway, I'm preaching and I'm not teaching, so. Now, we want to go back to where we were in the Jesus Movement page, lesson. How far did we get? Didn't we get to Roman numeral 2?
Yes.
So did we do Roman numeral 2?
No.
That's where we left off, right? Okay. So, the Jesus Movement, Roman numeral 2, the followers of Jesus, the apostles, and the early church. The religious movement begun by Jesus of Nazareth did not end with his death, but rather emerged in Jerusalem with even greater vitality under the leadership of his closest disciples who came to be called the apostles. The word is apostles. Apostle is one who is sent on behalf of. Analogy to what an apostle is an ambassador, someone who's speaking on behalf of whoever sent them. So Jesus sent the apostles out. B, many of the followers of Jesus had experienced very profound encounters with the resurrected Jesus shortly after his death. The phenomenon of the resurrection appearances. By the way, resurrection is R-E-S-U-R-R-E-C-T-I-O-N. Appearances of Jesus becomes the single most important fact in the thinking of the apostles and followers of Jesus. To them, the essence of preaching the gospel is preaching the person of Jesus, but next to preaching the person of Jesus, you're preaching his resurrection. That's what they proclaimed. And they really believed it. So let's say we have doubts about the resurrection, because we as moderns are skeptical by nature. Okay, but you can doubt whether there was a resurrection, but you can't doubt that they believed it. So something happened. And you're left with trying to explain it, because it was a large number of people who believed this, and they even died for their testimony. Now, psychologically speaking, people will die for a cause that is untrue if they believe it to be true. But no one's going to sacrifice their life for something they know is a lie. I mean, that would be that many people to do that. I think that would be a near impossibility. So I don't think there is any doubt. No historian doubts the sincerity of the followers of Jesus who believed it. So something happened. And I remember watching a debate between someone who was a skeptic when it came to the resurrection, and someone who was a scholar who accepted the resurrection as a matter of his own faith. But they both agreed something did happen. You know, they could have been mistaken and thought it was a resurrection, but something happened that totally transformed them and created this community. C, the apostles proclaimed a message based upon their experiences with Jesus of Nazareth. This proclamation is called, and I'm going to write this word down. This is an important technical word. Let me see, I want to be able to spell it right. It's called kerygma. K-E-R, I think it, yeah, Y, kerygma. Is that right, Diane? Kerygma? I think so. K-E-R-Y-G-M-A, kerygma, which means simply the proclamation. And the kerygma, the apostolic kerygma, which I already have spelled out for you right there on the page, followed a very definite formula. This was a formulaic presentation of the message. The reason why they would reduce a message to a formula, because it's easy, oral transmission, you remember it better. And so if you look at the sermons of Peter in the Acts of the Apostles, and even Paul, they have what is called the kerygma. It always follows this outline. Number one, the kerygma, the first point is that Jesus of Nazareth was the Messiah promised through the ancient prophets. That's the first thing they'll tell you. That's the first point of the kerygma. Number two, that Jesus performed saving actions or acts, miracles, healings, and exorcisms. They always mention that in fulfillment of his messianic mission. There was always a reason why he did miracles. He wasn't there just to thrill people with impressive actions. It was for the purpose of establishing the kingdom of God. Number three, that Jesus was put to death for our sins. That's part of the kerygma. Now, there's various ways to interpret that, but that's another, we'll get into that another time. But that is a part of the kerygma. Number four, that Jesus was raised from the dead and exalted by God the Father and is now seated at God's right hand in heaven. Number five, that Jesus will come again and soon. Jesus will come again soon. And number six, that everyone who hears and believes this message is to repent, metanoia, change their mind, be baptized, and become a part of the way. This is what the Jesus movement was called. Its first name was the way. Before it was called Christians and Christianity, they were called the Way. Before it was even called the Church, it was called the Way. That was the name of this community of Jesus. They called it the Way. So, those are the 6 points of the kerygma, and you'll see that again and again. It's a formulaic presentation of the message. Don't salespeople do that? Do you know? They kind of have their different points and, you know, talking point. Talking, oh, this is great. The kerygma is the talking points. I love that. I got to put this in my, I'll rewrite this. I love that. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Diane, Mother Diane. Okay, D, the Jesus movement continues to, oh yeah.
Can I go back?
Yeah, you want to go back? Okay.
Yeah, I want to go back to number four.
Yeah.
That Jesus was raised from the dead and exalted by God the Father and is now seated at God's right hand in heaven. The seated at God's right hand in heaven goes back to the notion of the Son of Man in the book of Daniel, and the Son of, and one like the Son of Man is seated at the right hand of God.
Yeah.
In that passage, I think it's chapter 7 or so in Daniel. I think that that's very important to realize, that the divinity of Christ in the fact of the resurrection mirrors in some ways, this claim about Jesus mirrors what is in that that literature, that in that literature, and
the Daniel prophecy,
and
which was written about 250 years before.
Mm-hmm. And the reason why I think that's important is leads to my second point, and that is because of us moderns. I think it's pretty easy for us in this day and age to acknowledge that Jesus was a real human being. Okay, he was a human being. The problem for most people is the claim that he's God.
Nowadays, moderns have a problem with that.
That is not the problem in the early church. Everybody acknowledged that Jesus was divine. Given the events of the resurrection, his divinity comes through loud and clear, and especially when you're looking at texts, the early texts.
Yeah.
The problem that evolved was he really human?
Yeah.
It's the opposite problem to
see,
our
in the ancient mind, yeah, they had no problem accepting Jesus divine, but he only seemed to be human. It was not really. Yeah.
That's the heresy of docetism.
Yeah. He only seemed to be human. But and this is why, and we'll get into that when we get our section on Christology, the human and the divine in Jesus. Okay, so the Jesus movement continues to grow in Jerusalem and then in Galilee under the leadership of the apostles. The most prominent of these apostles are Peter. Write down the name Peter. That's an important name, Peter. And James. And there are a lot of people called James. And in the New Testament, but this particular James is the one who's called the Lord's brother. Now, the question is, who is James, the Lord's brother, if Jesus was the only child of Mary? How's James? And so the earliest tradition we have to explain this is that Joseph was older than Mary, which would not have been unusual. She was just 13 or 14 years old when she was betrothed and had Jesus to Joseph. Joseph, in all likelihood, according to this point of view, was previously married, was a widower, and he had children. So Jesus had half-siblings, so to speak. So James is... one of the things we know about James is that James did not believe in Jesus when Jesus had his earthly ministry. He was not a follower of his brother. However, the most ancient tradition says that after Jesus was raised from the dead, he makes a special appearance to James, his brother. So much so, James is there on the day of Pentecost, and James becomes the head of the church in Jerusalem. Interestingly enough, it's not Peter in Jerusalem. It's James, the brother of Jesus. The Jewish historian Josephus makes lots of references to James. So James, we know, is a historical figure, and he was regarded as the brother of our Lord. Okay, now, the Jesus movement at first is a religious movement within Judaism. That is, it is essentially a sect within Judaism. In the first century in Palestine, there were many different, if you will, Jewish denominations. Just like we have a lot of different, here in America, we have a lot of Christian denominations. In the Judaism of the first century, there were different groups and sects and denominations, if you will. So rarely is a religion just one thing. I was actually surprised to learn that Islam, early on, was divided into two major groups, and then there's all kinds of other groups besides. So it's not one thing. And that's the way it was in the Judaism of the first century. There was a lot of diversity, a lot of variety, different communities. We are introduced to some of them in the, we have the Pharisees and the Sadducees and different ones, the Essenes and different Jewish groups. But when the Romans came and destroyed the temple and destroyed Jerusalem, all of the other sects of Judaism disappeared. Only two survived. What two survived? The Pharisees became rabbinical Judaism. So the Jews that are in the world today are descendants of the Pharisees, or of that form of Judaism. And since they had no temple, then they shifted the centrality of Torah study in place of temple of observance. And that's how they were able to survive. The only other group that survived that was a Jewish sect or denomination was the Way, the Christians. So really, Christianity is a type of Judaism. Okay, now, where was I?
Middle of E.
Middle of E. Okay, the followers of Jesus at this time were observant Jews, following all of the traditions and practices of their ancestral religion. The only distinctive feature of the Jesus movement was their belief that Jesus was the Messiah. So if you were to take an H.G. Wells time machine and go back in time and show up in the first century, and you would have visited Jerusalem and gone to a Jewish synagogue and then gone to a Christian synagogue at a time when they weren't even called Christians, they were called the Way, you could hardly tell the difference between them, because they were both practicing Judaism. The only difference is that the Jesus movement at this time, the Way, just they looked and practiced all of Judaism, except they had this one additional belief: Jesus was the Messiah. F, the majority of the followers of the Way were Palestinian Jews. Remember, I put that on the board, Palestinian Jews. Like Jesus and the apostles, they spoke Aramaic and lived in Palestine. G, the next most significant development in the Jesus movement occurred when Hellenistic Jews, Greek-speaking Jews of the diaspora, which I wrote on the board for you, and I'll move out of your way so you can, you have that? Began to become followers of the Way. Prominent leaders in the Jesus movement among the Hellenistic Jews were Stephen and Philip. What is significant about Stephen?
He's the first.
Besides the cameraman?
First martyr.
He is the first martyr after Jesus. First one to shed his blood after Jesus. So you got a lofty name, Stephen. Yeah. There you go. Yeah, we can go out and have a drink a beer and talk about how profound our names are. Okay. H, a persecution of the Hellenistic Jewish followers of the Way began in Jerusalem after a bitter confrontation between the Sanhedrin, which is the highest governing body of the Jews, and Stephen, which led to the martyrdom of Stephen. Martyrdom, M-A-R-T-Y. R-D-O-M, the martyrdom of Stephen. At this time, Saul of Tarsus, who was employed by the Sanhedrin, became the bitterest opponent of the Jesus movement. Saul was a young rabbi. He was younger than Jesus, probably. And he was a religious fanatic. And he was a highly educated Jew. He was a student of one of the most prominent rabbis of the first century. That teacher was Gamaliel. And Saul was radically devoted to his faith, and he saw the Way as a threat to Judaism. So he wanted to eradicate it. That was simply what he wanted to do. And the Sanhedrin was more than happy to have this young firebrand rabbi do their dirty work for them. So they gave him authorization to arrest the followers of the Way, not Aramaic-speaking Palestinian Jews, but only the Hellenistic Jews. Do you see the difference? Mm-hmm. Now, Why did they become more concerned with the Hellenistic Jews, and they were more bothered by the Hellenistic Jews than the Palestinian Jews? That's a rhetorical question. I didn't expect you to know that, but maybe you did. I'll tell you why. Because when Stephen started preaching, and we have his sermon, so to speak, his message, he did something that none of the other disciples of Jesus ever did. And Stephen saw the implication of what it meant, the death of Jesus, and it meant we no longer need the temple. So Stephen enraged the Sanhedrin, because not before that, the Sanhedrin found the Jesus movement an irritation. But the Hellenistic Jews gave a certain spin to the message and made it more radical. Up until that, the Palestinian Jews freely went to the temple and still offered sacrifices at the temple. Still were good practicing Jews, kept all the festivals and all that. James, the brother of Jesus, did that to the end of his life. However, Stephen was saying, we don't need to do that anymore. We don't need the temple. Do you see how that is a threat to the establishment? Yeah, you know, so you don't speak against the temple. That's why they killed Stephen.
Yeah, because they're also probably weren't supporting it financially, which was a big deal.
Well, yeah, and guess who had all the money? The Hellenistic Jews. So if they say, oh, we don't need the temple anymore, then the economy of the temple is threatened, which is what finances the power base of the Sanhedrin. Okay. So they had to get rid of him. So they then employ Saul to go out and go after these Hellenistic Jews who are followers of the way and bring them back. He had warrants for their arrest. And so he takes a journey from Jerusalem to Syria to a place called Damascus, the road to Damascus. You know the story. Okay. Now, am I on I?
Yep.
Oh, good. Through the missionary efforts of the Hellenistic Jewish followers of the way, the Jesus movement spreads to Samaria. We've already mentioned that. Damascus, and most importantly, this is really important, to Antioch of Syria. Antioch is a major city. Antioch of Syria. And all of a sudden, Christianity, which is the way, not called Christianity yet, takes root in Antioch. And we have in Antioch the formation of the first megachurch. It was a big thing in Antioch of Syria. It was a huge Christian community. And it was there that people began calling the disciples of Jesus Christians. That's the importance of Antioch of Syria. Another thing is, Antioch of Syria started preaching the gospel to Gentiles, and Gentiles and Greeks were coming into the church. So that's when it really first started happening. And then in addition to that, the church of Antioch decided to sponsor missionary journeys and send people out to other cities to start new churches. And the first missionary team they send out is Saul of Tarsus, who now is a believer, the Apostle Paul, and his friend Barnabas. And that's when Christianity really begins to spread in a very intentional, programmatic way. They had a program. Paul had a strategy. Go to each town and city, and wherever there's a Jewish synagogue, go there. And since Paul was a rabbi, when you have a guest rabbi, you always ask him to make a commentary on the Torah. Paul just said, thank you, brothers. Now I'll tell you about the Messiah. So he'll go through this whole thing, giving the history of Israel. And everyone's going, yeah, yeah, yeah. Even though they hear this story 1,000 times over, yeah, yeah, yeah. They can't hear it enough. You know, tell the story. And then all of a sudden he shifts and he says, now, I want to tell you about the Messiah. And he would preach Jesus to them, and many would believe, and others would resist, and it would be controversy, and then they would throw him out of the synagogue. So he would open up shop down the street, start preaching, and he would start a church, and it would still create controversy. And so a mob eventually would come and get him and drag him out and stone him, and he survives. And this was the typical pattern of Paul's missionary journey. He would stay until he wasn't welcome anymore. The guy was dedicated. Okay, yeah.
Another point, and that is that the Gentile community in Antioch and elsewhere was not monolithic. There were Gentiles who are called God-fearers,
yeah,
who were very attracted to Judaism. But because the men would have to undergo the rite of circumcision, which was regarded as mutilation in the Gentile communities, they wouldn't become full-fledged Jews. But they would go to the synagogue, and they yeah. would listen to the sermons, and they would listen to the scriptures, and they were very familiar with the moral codes and the laws of Judaism. They just hadn't taken that last step to become Jewish. So when someone like Paul comes, they're ripe for conversion.
Because yeah.
You don't have to get it
stamped. Yeah. No mutilation, yeah.
No mutilation. I mean, and was
just baptized. Oh, water only? We can deal with that, yeah. That's true. That's very true.
Yeah, it was.
So.
And that really needs to be remembered and said, because when they get thrown out of the synagogue and they go right down the street and set up shop, I mean, you can go to some of these cities where they're doing archaeological digs and you can see the remains of the synagogue, and right down the road there's the remains of the church.
Yeah.
You know, that's what they were doing.
It's quite extraordinary.
Yeah, it is.
So there was a rivalry between the Jews and the Christians very early on. Okay. Jay, in his effort to suppress the Jesus movement, Saul of Tarsus encounters the resurrected Jesus on the road to Damascus. This profound spiritual experience led to Saul's conversion to the way. And I wish more people would have those kinds of encounters. I have to say that some of my friends have been telling me that there's a lot of Muslims in the Middle East that have become really disillusioned with Islam. But they can't publicly convert or anything like that, so they become secret believers in Jesus. And most of them become believers in Jesus, and this just seems to be happening, and it's widespread. Muslims are having visions where Jesus and dreams where Jesus comes to them. Yeah, so we don't really know how many of these secret Muslim followers of Jesus are over in the Middle East, but it's quite extraordinary. And you can find on YouTube testimonies from Muslims after they've left the Middle East, of course, because it's dangerous. You can't convert. It's against the law to convert if you're a Muslim. So they become followers of Jesus, and are, in fact, a lot of the refugees that came into Germany. This is interesting because Western Europe, and Germany is one of those countries in Western Europe, Christianity is on the decline. They call it the post-Christian era. The churches are really museums.
Right.
They're mostly empty. Well, now the churches are filled with worshipers, and it's Syrians who have come, and they had to rent the use of a huge Olympic-sized swimming pool to baptize them all. So a lot of these Muslims who are coming into Germany are embracing Christianity, and now these churches that were half empty are now filled with parishioners, and they're Syrians. And so now the native German Christians are going, maybe we missed something here. It's just a fascinating story.
Yeah, we should perhaps pray for that.
Yes.
Situation.
Yeah. Yeah, it's quite extraordinary. I'll try to find you some links and get it to you. But I'm mentioning that because we think of Saul as having, you know, he was so unique. He had this encounter of a vision of Jesus, the resurrected Christ, on the road to Damascus. But now I'm hearing stories it's happening again, this kind of stuff. Saul of Tarsus, K. Well, did I read?
No, we haven't done it.
Oh. In his effort to suppress the Jesus movement, Saul of Tarsus encounters the resurrected Jesus on the road to Damascus. This profound spiritual experience led to Saul's conversion to the way. K. Saul of Tarsus was uniquely qualified to provide a theological, the word's theological, rationale to the early proclamation of the kerygma of the early church. Let me put it this way. The kerygma simply tells you what happened. So you have Peter and John and James, they're saying, these things happen. The kerygma. They could tell you what happened because they were the witnesses. But Paul, this is the importance of Saul, who becomes Paul to us. He not only heard what happened from the witness of the disciples, he could articulate why it happened. He's the first theologian because he could give a rationale as to the meaning of what was going on, what the crucifixion meant, what the resurrection means. These are things that Saul was able to articulate. Why? Because he was highly educated. He came from the leading rabbinical school of Jerusalem. This guy was a genius. So Peter could tell you what happened, Paul could tell you why. Do you like that distinction?
Yeah.
So Saul would quickly become an important proponent and leader of the Jesus movement. Saul later would become better known as the Apostle Paul. So one and the same guy. Okay. Are we on L, everybody?
Yeah.
You there? You made it? You're still with me? Okay, I know this gets tedious. Approximately 10 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth, the Jesus movement begins to spread for the first time to non-Jewish Gentile people. The conversion of Cornelius, a Roman and an Italian, to the way through the preaching of Peter opened the door for future Gentile conversions. This is a big moment. Paul the Apostle becomes the most important missionary to the Gentiles. By the close of the first century, within 70 years of the death of Jesus and resurrection of Jesus, the majority of the followers of the way are now called Christians, and they are Gentiles. Who are now called Christians are Gentiles. Number four, the Jesus movement, the Christianization of the Hellenistic world. Hellenistic world. Should I spell that for you? Helen, is it somewhere there?
Yeah, in the center of a circle.
Oh, good! There it is, everybody! Okay. And the Hellenization of Christianity. So not only do we have the Christianization of Greece or the Hellenistic world, but at the same time, the Greeks make a contribution and transform Christianity. What do the Greeks contribute to Christianity? Their vast philosophical tradition. And so now, the Greeks give us a language and an ability to be able to think rationally about the Jesus event, the Christ event. Okay, A. By the close of the first century, the Jesus movement had grown from a local Palestinian religious movement inspired by Jesus of Nazareth to an international phenomenon that was quickly spreading throughout the Roman Empire and beyond. By the way, it had a westward trajectory into the Greek world, but there were missionaries that began to go east beyond the eastern frontier of the Roman Empire into Iran, into Iraq. At one time, there were more Christians in Iraq than there was in Rome, Italy. And the tradition is that Thomas, one of the 12, went all the way to India and established and planted the Christian church there. So when Western missionaries came, the Portuguese, Roman Catholic missionaries came there in the 1500s, they already found that there was a Christian church already there. And they asked them, well, what's your story? Well, Thomas came to India. We'll show you where he's buried. And you know Father Chinapa, who's a part of our church? I was talking to him in a conversation. Have you ever been to the tomb of Thomas? Oh, yes, yes. Yeah, Thomas, he started the first church in India. It's fascinating, isn't it? In the first century, the Jesus movement can be divided into three distinct periods. This is first century only. There's what we call, number one, the apostolic period. Apostolic. A-P. Apostolic period. A-P-O-S-T-O-I-L-I-C. Apostolic period. This is the period from the death of Jesus to the passing of the last apostle. So roughly from 30 to 65, for about 35 years, is called the apostolic era. This is when the epistles of Paul were being written. Then number two, we have the sub-apostolic. So it's the same word, but you add sub with a hyphen, the sub-apostolic period. That's the second generation. That's people like Titus and Timothy and Mark, who wrote the gospel that bears his name, according to tradition. That's the sub-apostolic period. Then number three, we have what is called the post-apostolic period. This is, we're getting close, the end of the second generation and the beginning of the third generation. And that starts 95 and goes to about 120. So that's about 90 years. And each of those periods are divided into roughly 30-year segments. The apostolic period, the sub-apostolic period, and the post-apostolic period. So by the time you get through the post, the reason why these three are important, because some of the New Testament was written in each of those periods. By the time of the close of the post-apostolic period, the New Testament books are all there, already in existence. C, the chief centers of the Christian movement by the end of the first century were, number one, Jerusalem, Palestine. Number two, Antioch of Syria. Number three, Alexandria of Egypt. Number four, Ephesus of Asia Minor. And five, Rome. And these would be called the five great patriarchates, or those were major churches in the ancient world. Okay, so there we are. Any questions or thoughts about what we've gone over so far? Okay, I think this will be a good place to leave off, even though it's a little early, but I wanted to bring to your attention, can I borrow this from you? For those of you who are in the St. Cyprian School of Theology for the Diaconal Formation Program, this little tiny...
I think I have one that's gray.
Could be, but this is, it's by Richard McBrien or McBreen, a Roman Catholic theologian from Notre Dame in Indiana. He just recently passed away, but this is a great presentation of the Catholic faith, and it mirrors a lot of what we're doing in this class. Those of you who are not in the St. Cyprian and are doing this for either your own enrichment or you're doing it for... in preparation of confirmation, you don't have to get this book. It's not required reading, but you can. And start to work your way through it.
Really cheap on, what was that?
Abe Books. You could probably pick it up for $3. Mm-hmm. Real cheap.
And
ABE Books. Yeah. Amazon's pretty good, but Abe Books are even better for cheap books. And there's a hard, if you like a hardbound edition, they come in hardbound edition. But it's well written, and it will be useful to you if you really want to dig deeper. And you'll immediately see as you're getting, when you get past the introduction, as you get through it, that a lot of what you're hearing in this class will be reflected in this book. Okay, so if you are a student of the St. Cyprian School of Theology. This is your textbook, and you must start reading it. Well, I don't have to tell you you have to, because you'll start reading it, and you will not be able to put it down. Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Okay, everybody, any questions or thoughts about the Jesus movement or what we went over so far? Okay, I hope I kept you awake and your mind's well lubricated. Okay.
I do have a question, I'm sorry, I just was thinking.
Okay.
It had to do with the distinction between the resurrection of Jesus and then also his, murdered, literally. You know,
yeah.
His passion.
Yeah.
Now, in the early church, was the emphasis on the passion of Jesus a big thing, or was it just part of the story and the resurrection was the emphasis? Because that's always been interesting to me, because sometimes it seems like it goes back and forth, but a lot of times I think the Catholic, and a lot of Christians do get caught up in that whole passion of Jesus, and like, he died for us and our sins and la la la. And so it's always been very interesting to me how all that plays out.
Well, the passion was extremely important to the first generation. Its narrative takes up the majority of the narrative space in all four of the Gospels. It's really important. So we know that they told the story frequently, and so it did leave an impression on them. You know, there were people who really were there and witnessed that. However, the resurrection clearly was the most important. I mean, that's really what they were proclaiming. Jesus was not just a martyr. What made it different is that he was resurrected. And I don't know that you could artificially separate the two. The passion of Jesus, which is his suffering and his death, and the resurrection of Jesus is two parts of two acts in a play. It's like they go together. You don't have one without the other. It's just that this was the faith that they proclaimed. They proclaimed his death, but they also proclaimed his resurrection. And his death would have no meaning apart from the resurrection. The resurrection is what gives us death meaning.
Right. I just think that sometimes it's emphasized more in the history of the church at different times. Like, you know, looking at the crucifix, for example, you see that, you know, the suffering Jesus, whereas there's been some, you know, where they've gotten rid of that in some churches, and you see the resurrected Jesus.
You're making a really good observation. Latin, and we haven't gotten to that because we're only talking about the Greeks, but Latin Christianity more and more put the emphasis on the death of Jesus, so that what we call the Western Church, the Latin Church, really began. You almost get the impression through its liturgy and iconography and its theology that they were more interested in his death than they were his resurrection. It's about emphasis. They certainly proclaimed the resurrection, but it was all the focus was on his death. And because of that, the heirs of Latin Christianity are the Roman Catholic Church and the Protestants. And the Protestants and the Roman Catholics, until quite recently, both really emphasized the death of Jesus. Because he died for, you'll hear things, he died for our sins, and that's the most important thing. And and now the Eastern Church, the Greeks, and Greek Christianity spread among the Slavs, so the Russian Orthodox Church, their emphasis, they talk about the death of Jesus, but they don't focus on that. It's the resurrection. So they have more of an interest in the resurrection. And I think that you need to keep the two. It's all about balance. Yes. Do you have, Diane, a comment about this?
Diane. Thank you.
Yeah.
The very early church was also very convinced that Jesus was going to come back again soon. So there's a third
there's yeah. third in a play we have acts, so that there's third act that they were looking forward to. And
yeah.
The other thing I want to mention is the reason why I think that the Passion partly gets as much play in the very early church as it did was because they started celebrating Eucharist just almost immediately, and this is my body and this is my blood. So
it was a daily thing that they were aware of, that they were, you know.
Yeah.
The death of Jesus is significant, and it was significant in that until I come back again, right? Do this in memory of me, basically until I mm-hmm. come right back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, Polly.
I think it's a guilt thing. I think you can control people better
yeah.
with guilt.
Well, and that's more true in the Western Church, yeah. both Catholic and Protestant, than it is in the Eastern Church.
Yes.
Yeah. Because, you know, your sins were so bad. Look what they had to do to Jesus so your sins could be forgiven. You get that kind of piety. There's always some truth in all of these things, but it is about emphasis. Another reason why the death of Jesus probably and the crucifixion became important in early church is because they were also being martyred. They were also dying. And so they, when they would go to their death, they would often think about and meditate and remember Jesus suffered and died. So this is a great privilege. I get to suffer and die like Jesus. And there was a really powerful movie that I took my sons to see this past Tuesday. It's called Silence. Yeah, and it's a Martin Scorsese film. Scorsese. It's about the widening circle of Christianity and Christianity through the Jesuits, who were Portuguese, and other Europeans were bringing Christianity to Japan, and they did their missionary work in Nagasaki, which is famous to us for other reasons, and the Japanese mission was enormously successful. And so within a very short period of time, the Japanese church grew to be 300,000. I'm giving you historical background. Then the powers that be in Japan felt threatened by Christianity because they saw it as something that was not Japanese. So they decided they were going to eradicate Christianity, and so they did. They really eradicated it. And the movie Silence is about that story. What were the conditions and what happened? And so Christianity was illegal from the middle of the 1600s to the middle of the 1800s in Japan. And then when Japan opened up to the West in like 1850s, then Christian missionaries went back to Japan, and everyone thought Christianity was dead, that it was eradicated. Well, they found in Nagasaki all of these Japanese Christians. They had no Bible, they had no organized church, they had no priest or anything, but they still practiced the Catholic devotions secretly, and they preserved it for 200 years. And they suffered. I recommend you see Silence, because you're going to be confronted with a moral dilemma that the priests were confronted with. And it's just powerful. It's a gripping movie, kind of along the lines of the mission. So if you can see Silence, I highly recommend it. But it's not a feel-good movie, right. You know. But at the same time, it's profound. And so even my youngest son, Joey, who saw it, he says, I really like this movie. Mm-hmm. And so I do highly recommend it. So, okay, everybody. This has been good tonight. Thank you for all your contributions. And let us join our hands.